Welcome back to the Hong Kong Greek Gastronomy and Diet Festival. Every time I try to remember all these words in the same sequence, and I think I'm getting better at that. We've got with us Pearl, who is my good colleague, associate professor in the School of Hotel and Tourism Management, and a very qualified chef as well.
Thanks.
Today we have with us Mariana Levi-Vitaki. Even for a Greek, it's quite difficult to say. How do we say that, Mariana?
Levi-Vitaki.
Levi-Vitaki, okay. I need a little bit of practice. Mariana used to be at Morito Restaurant for 12 years in London. She opened the restaurant as executive chef. And I kind of invited Mariana because she's got a very interesting background. She is the daughter of a fisherman, apparently. Greek fisherman and a Scottish mother, right? And there's a connection here with Pearl as well, because Pearl studied in Scotland for 4 years.
Yes.
So we kind of have a nice kind of connection. And welcome, Mariana.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
Now, I've seen somewhere your profile and I thought, what an interesting profile. And then I saw this wonderful video that you have done with these nice guys. And we decided that this is a lovely video to show, because you cooking on location. And you cook where, I guess, you grew up in Crete. And also, I love the story with the prawns afterwards. I was just showing that to Pearl a minute ago. And I said, look what the daughter of a fisherman had to do.
I think, basically, you know, I turned to cooking quite a few years ago. And I did it because it was a true passion. You know, I studied in the UK and I did 2 degrees. I did a bachelor's in psychology, then I did a master's in forensic psychology. And, you know, that was my studying. That was what initially I thought I wanted to do. And I loved every bit of it. But going into the field, I was young and quite fiery. And I was like, you know, just not sure this is exactly what I want. And having been brought up in Crete, in a family restaurant, because we had a seafood restaurant in the city I was born in, Chania, in the neighborhood of Halepa, I was basically brought up in a restaurant. So I had a lot of that experience. And slowly as I grew, I just became really interested in food. And I just found myself constantly like cooking or reading or trying to learn more and more and more. So I became a chef because it was something I absolutely felt passionate about and I loved. And it was like a turn in my other career that I was heading towards at the time. So when I cook, I think I just love it to be real, to be absolutely real. I don't like being in a studio. I don't like making my food look beautiful for a photograph because that's how it needs to be. I need to do it. I need to do it, photograph it, and then eat it or everyone else eat it. So cooking on location is for me key, you know, because the reason I cook is because I evoke memories that I have and then, you know, by sharing all of these elements, whether it's by the sea or in the mountains, or, you know, giving the watcher or the listener or the reader a story is what's important for me. So when I worked with Milk Street in Crete, they were absolutely incredible because we just did, I don't know, 1,000 kilometers in 5 days on the island of Crete, going everywhere, you know. And the dish you saw me cooking of the prawns and orzo and ouzo is exactly in the place where a restaurant used to be, where, you know, the memories in my head, the feelings, the smells, the noises are just so alive, you know. So it was extremely special that we could do that. And then I think my food tastes better when I make it somewhere I love.
Of course, because it's local and you've got local ingredients.
Chef Mariana, thank you so much for being with us. I do have some question for you. It's such a fantastic way to learn your experience and how your family influenced you on how you cook and develop all the flavors. And we are also here in Hong Kong. We have a lot of seafood, and where you were was also a lot of seafood. Is there anything you would introduce us? We can do something in Hong Kong with a Greek flavor.
Well, look, I'm sure, you know, your dishes are so amazing, and I'm always in awe, you know, with the way you cook. And I find it extremely difficult to be successful in any dish I try to make, but maybe because I haven't got the experience. In terms of, you know, Greek food or Cretan food, which is, you know, where I grew up. And I think the reason I had a lot of seafood in my life was because my dad was a fisherman, or yes, is a fisherman, mm-hmm, you know, still to this day. So we were a lucky family. We also had the seafood restaurant. Yes. So it's not that every single family, you know, in Crete eats a lot of fish, but we were that family. We were a fish family, yes, basically. And that was amazing because we got to eat seafood almost every day. So you kind of, mm-hmm, as children, we got to the stage where we would like, oh, mom, can you please cook something else? Can we please have some fried chicken? Or can you please make a beef stew? And she was like, oh, well, I don't know. We need to see what dad brings back from the sea today.
Yeah.
Because the A-class catch would go to the restaurant, mm-hmm, and the B-class, all the wonky, silly, half-eaten, tiny, not-so-perfect fish would go in a bucket and come home. So that was amazing in terms of how we ate it. But in terms of me giving you advice,
yes,
on what to do is a very difficult task for me, because I think Greek food is very simple. So the flavors are very much based on the seasons, and they're very much based on the ingredients that are local. Yes. And I think that was, of course, more the case, obviously, in the past. It was really kind of important. Now, as time goes by, you know, there's obviously big supermarkets and, yes, you know, ingredients that you can get all year round, you know, and that has, unfortunately for me, changed a bit, because eating the food from your land, not necessarily your land, but, you know, things that are local, things that are made in small productions, mm-hmm, in small batches that are looked after, are, you know, that's what makes it very special for me. But in terms of cooking dishes, you know, I think my advice is, you know, make sure your seafood is super fresh. Make sure it's almost moving. It's, mm-hmm, almost alive. You know, sometimes we would get fish that we would want to cook, and my dad would say, you need to leave it for a few hours. It's alive. If you put it on the charcoal, it will be tough and not, yes, nice. Let it rest, you know. So it was so fresh. But I think it's the same thing I do here in London. You know, I'm most probably the worst customer of my fishmonger, because I'm like, I don't like this. Oh, no, not this one. It's not perfect. You know, that's not today's catch, you know. So number one is get fresh stuff.
Yes.
And then what you do with it is up to you. But for me, it's the less you do, the more you taste the ingredient. And if you're lucky enough to have the luxury to eat beautiful fresh fish or seafood, then don't do too much to it. You know, keep it nice, keep it simple, because what you want is you want to have this flavor in your mouth of the seawater, of the iodine, you know, if it's a sea urchin, whatever you know, yes, you choose to have, but you want to keep it real. So not too much, not extreme flavors, you know, use good ingredients, and I think that's what I try to do every time with fish.
Mariana, I'll ask you two questions for two recipes, basically. One is the grill fish, because this is something that they don't do in Hong Kong. They steam fish here quite a lot.
Yes.
They boil, but they don't grill. Although last Sunday, mm-hmm. I went to Tai O, which is a fishing village.
Tai O, yes.
And they were grilling calamari on the street, on a very small kind of barbecue.
Dry calamari.
Yeah. But they were killing it, actually.
Yes, yes.
We grill it in a much better way.
Yeah.
So one is how we are grilling fish, and what's your secret? And the second thing is kakavya, that you probably have, you have it in your book, The Aegean Islands Cooking. Kakavya is the fisherman's soup.
Oh, fisherman's soup.
Every fisherman cooks kakavya, which is very specific to Greece.
Wow.
Yeah.
So your advice on grilled fish and kakavya?
Well, I think grilling fish is a fantastic way of having it. Obviously, because, you know, getting a little bit of the smokiness from fire, cooking over fire for me is one of my favorite ways of cooking. Whether it's fish or meat, it doesn't really matter. But I think you need to be able to understand the method. So even though it might be very easy to cook over fire, you think, fine, I'll light a fire, I'll cook my fish. It's a little bit more complicated like that. But as soon as you understand the basics, you can grill anything. You can grill fish, you can grill octopus, you can grill cuttlefish, you can grill squid, calamari, you can grill prawns.
She's getting hungry. I can see Pearl is getting hungry.
It's one of those ways where you actually keep it very simple. In Greece, when we grill fish, you will 9 out of 10 times, the only thing that goes over the seafood that you've grilled is very good olive oil,
yes,
from the island, and very good lemons from your tree or an auntie's tree,
yes,
or a granny's tree. They're big, they're full of juice, you know, and salt. And obviously the salt is not any kind of salt. It's salt, again, picked in the right season, you know, from the Sea of Crete. So I think what you need to do and make sure, I mean, our restaurant, it's quite amazing that you mentioned the grilling, because in our restaurant for 30 years, or as long as I can remember, because I don't remember all of the years we had it, there was a 6-meter charcoal grill in the kitchen. So it was 6 meter. The whole wall was a charcoal grill. So we would go in, when I took over the kitchen at that restaurant for a few years, we would go in and the first thing you do is light your charcoal.
Yeah.
So you would make a big pile of charcoal from your sack and light it. And we would cover it with tin foil to make it warm and make it happen quicker. Now, when this big pile of charcoal was lit and hot, and when I say lit, I don't mean flames, I mean hot red charcoal, we would spread it all across the grill. So you would have what my father used to call the mother. So it'd be the mother where you would feed more charcoal. And then when it was ready to cook with, you would spread it with like a shovel. We had a big shovel type thing, like a garden tool, actually. It wasn't anything specific. And you would spread it all across the 6 meters. And everything needed different heat. So at the beginning of the service, you would do cuttlefish and octopus and kind of give it a head start. So it would go raw on the flame, on the charcoal, on a griddle, but you didn't want much heat. So you needed to understand this, how do I get the right heat so I don't burn it, because you didn't want it burnt, but I cook it so it doesn't need any extra cooking. It doesn't need to go in the oven. It doesn't need anything else. You do everything over the hot coals. So as long as your charcoal's perfectly lit, as long as it's spread equally over the surface, as long as it's, you put your hand over it. And I think if you count to 10, and then you have to move your hand because it's too hot, you're at about the right temperature.
Yep.
And you can add fish on your griddle, you can add whatever else you want. Obviously, everything cooks in different times. And the secret with fish is you don't want to turn your fish all the time, because you lose juices. So you want to cook it on one side, flip it, cook it on the other side, take it off and eat it quickly with olive oil and lemon. And you don't need to season it. It's very simple. The only thing we put on all the seafood before it went on the fire was salt. That was it. Nothing else. No pepper, no oregano, nothing. It was just sea salt, thick rock sea salt, generous amounts. You cook it, take it off, olive oil, lemon, and a nice loaf of fresh bread.
There's
no
better meal than that, actually. There's absolutely
no better. So hungry now.
It's delicious, and I think it's a celebration of the ingredient because that's what you have. And in places like Crete, you know, very often what you would have with that would be just a lovely seasonal salad or foraged wild greens, you know, that have been blanched, that are known in Crete, you know, eaten very, very often, different types of wild greens depending on the season. So the meals are super simple. So in that way, you know, there's not much you're doing. It's just more about how you do it. Yeah. It's about not losing your you know, not thinking, oh, this is super simple. It's not, because for you to cook a fish that is extremely juicy, that a knife will just make the flesh fall off the central bone as butter, you know, and it's not dry and you just have it on its own, you know, is the best thing for me, at least.
Absolutely.
You know. Totally.
Give us your cacavia recipe as well, because cacavia is a very special kind of thing to Greeks. And is it similar to anything else in international cuisine, or is that unique to Greece?
I think it's very unique to Greece. You know, I think every fisherman has their own recipe, and every fisherman thinks their recipe is the best in the world. But also it's quite funny because they all use the same ingredients. So it can't be that different. But it's quite a funny thing among men, because I remember when I was really young, my father used to go fishing, and then sometimes he went fishing in like an area that was a 2-hour drive from our house. So we would all go and like kind of, he would say, do you want to all go fishing? We wouldn't go on the boat with him. We would camp or, you know, sleep in rooms or, you know, and there were quite a few other fishermen. They would all go out in separate boats and work overnight. In the morning, they would come in with all these not perfect fish. You know, all the leftovers, all the funny ones, eels that, you know, you accidentally catch. You don't really want to catch eels because no one really, you know, they don't sell very well, but they get caught. Lots of them get caught, and they are actually delicious. So all these, this bucket of miscellaneous, funny, small, big, half-eaten, long, short fish would be cleaned by the women, which is amazing. So the women would clean the fish, the women would clean the potatoes, and the men would make the cacavia. So usually it was an outdoor activity, and there's a big gas hob and a big pot. The potatoes go in the bottom, a single layer, nice big chunks of lovely potatoes, and then all the fish is thrown on top of the potatoes, and then you put an enormous amount of olive oil. So literally, it's almost equal amounts of water and olive oil. So a lot, but you know, there isn't that issue of how much olive oil, or olive oil is expensive. I mean, every family most probably uses about 10 liters a week, you know. So olive oil on top of the fish, lots of salt and water, but just enough. This is the most crucial. Just enough to cover the fish. So do not cover the fish completely. Then you put the lid on, fire on full blast. You bring it to the boil. You cook it for about 20 minutes, depending on the fish, on the size of the fish in there. You turn it off. You squeeze lots of fresh lemon, and then you let it sit and you let it relax. So when you go back to this pot and you lift it, it's actually like a cream. So the gelatin from the fish together with the olive oil and the water has just created this amazing emulsion that is, it's just, it's like medicine. That's the only way I can describe it. So we used to sit outdoors in these long tables by the harbour where the fishermen would sit and everyone would sit, the kids, you know, any passerby. And sometimes you weren't even given a spoon. You were given the Cretan rusks, like really hard bread. And they're like, you don't need a spoon to eat your kakavya. So you would eat your fish with the hand, get the bones on one side, use this rusks hard bread to kind of soak it in the soup. And they would never, ever give you large portions. That was amazing because Greeks are all about a lot of food, a lot, you know, eat, 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 eat. But with kakavya, you always got quite a small plate. And I was like, why, you know, why is this, you know, and it, and when you have it, you realize that it's so rich and so filling that if you did have a big bowl of it, most probably you'd never be able to get off the table, you know. So it's an amazing soup. And then, you know, moving forward, we come to a restaurant or a recipe book where I wrote the recipe and you tend to use a bigger fish, you know, something with, you know, again, a lot of gelatin like turbot here, or, you know, something that has that has richness to give to the broth, you know. So it's versatile in that way. You know, you can use one big fish or you can use lots of tiny fish. You know, it depends how comfortable you are with fish eating as well, because if you use tiny fish, then, you know, you've got lots of bones and you have to get your hands dirty. But that's the whole fun of it. You know, it's a rustic soup. It's the fisherman's soup, you know. So when we used to do it at the restaurant, I wasn't allowed to do it for about 15 years.
Wow. Oh,
it was like, no. We've got a kakavya in order. I'm doing it, my dad would say. Or, you know, you're not doing it. Even though I would cook the whole menu, I would go in, do all the prep, work so hard, be in charge of the kitchen. If a kakavya came on order, he'd be like, no, I'll do it. I'm like, I know how to do it. He's like,
it's a not yet. Yeah. It's watch. A very special thing. That's why I mentioned it.
Yeah, so I finally got to make them and he was very happy with the result. But it took a lot of time to persuade him. It took a lot of years of just watching, understanding, tasting the oil, seeing how much you want to put, thinking of the size of your fish. And this is a dish that has four ingredients, right? Yeah. It just has potato and fish and olive oil and salt. Yeah. You know, it's like, that's it. But it's one of those dishes that, you know, you sit around the table with family or friends, you know, and you have it and you feel good, you know, you feel satisfied, you feel that it's real and it's not pretentious. It's
and
something
very healthy
that,
too.
You know, very healthy. Very healthy. It's definitely, you know, it's one to keep you strong, I would say.
So, Chef, thank you so much for sharing with us the fisherman's soup. Is there anything else you would put in the fisherman's soup?
There's variations. So you will go to households in Greece and they will say to you, I cooked a fish soup today. Would you like some? And you will go to houses where they said, I've made a kakavya today. Would you like some? So when we talk about kakavya, it's something very traditional and it's, as I described, a very simple soup made with four ingredients, the most important thing being the fresh fish and the gelatinous fish. Yeah. If you go down the other route of a fish soup, it's made very differently. People use various types of fish. The method of that extreme high heat to create an emulsion, enormous amounts of olive oil is not part of it. There is olive oil and there is heat, but everything is more calm.
Yeah.
And in these soups, you would use things like celery, like carrot, like fennel, like parsley. So you would, and this is more of an aromatic broth.
Yeah.
So it's much looser. It's more. It's not thick. It's not emulsified, and it's just like a fish broth with where you can actually smell the aromas of all these lovely vegetables. That's also very nice, you know. But that's a different thing. So in a kakavya, of course you can add whatever you want, you know. Mm-hmm. You can add some parsley stalks, you know, if you've got some spare, and then, you know, yeah, finely chop them so you don't waste them. You can add carrot, you can add celery, but it's not a kakavya.
Yeah. Yeah. Kakavya is the best.
Yeah.
I think Mariana, you need to send us the recipe from your book, and actually, yes, you need to send us the cover of the book, and we will include that on the video, because my mouth is getting watered, and I cannot wait, yes, to kind of try,
yes,
that.
Yes.
Thank you very much for being with us, and thank you very much for sharing
you
all
so
your
much,
passion.
Jeff.
And it's you. Wonderful to actually hear your story that fueled your passion for food.
Yes.
And we can only hope that we are going to go to Crete very soon, all of
I
us,
know.
And enjoy yes, the local food and the local seafood, mm-hmm, in particular.
Lovely. Well, thank you for having me. It was
thank
a pleasure
so
to have a chat.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Take
okay.
care. See you soon.
Bye-bye.
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 Bye.
This week on Mill Street, we traveled to Crete to meet Mariana Leiva-Tataki, who gives us a tour of her island. She also cooks up her braised beef with figs and cabbage. Plus, we make another Cretan specialty, shrimp, orzo, and zucchini with ouzo and mint. So please stay tuned as we explore the cooking of Crete.
Today we're in Agia Kyriaki at almost the exact spot our family restaurant used to be for, you know, 30 odd years. It's my favorite view. I've spent every single evening of my childhood here. Coming back and being able to cook while seeing this is a special moment for me, and I'm super happy to show you this. What I'm going to cook is a really beautiful beef stew, and I usually serve it with this fast pickled salad. So I get my pot, carefully place it over medium heat, and get a little bit of olive oil. And I'm just going to add the beef to brown it. In the meantime, I'm going to cut tomatoes up. Your recipe calls for a can of tomato, but I'm going to use fresh tomatoes because they are amazing at the moment. So it's just a little change that I can't really resist. So just going over and dicing them. Okay, so tomatoes are chopped. I'm just going to check the beef. Beef still needs a few minutes, so I'm just going to transfer my tomatoes into a bowl and continue with my figs. I've got really lovely dried figs that are from here, and I've also got some fresh ones, so Yes, the recipe doesn't say use fresh figs. We are in Crete and the fig trees are overloaded at the moment. So I'm just going to do it. As a lover of good food and ingredients, I cannot not use a few red fresh figs in this recipe. So very roughly chopped. As you can see, they're just absolutely amazing. They're like honey inside. I think they will add a really lovely texture and freshness and lift to our stew. I also have my dry figs because they add this really nice richness to the stew. And usually you would make it with dry figs. Figs are ready, tomatoes are ready, juniper berries are here. Last check on the beef. Almost there. So here we go. In with the tomatoes, and we will follow with our figs and juniper berries. So I haven't got a mortar and pestle, so I'm just adding them whole, and then they will give the flavor to my stew and I can remove them. I'm just going to top up with a little bit of water. Salt and pepper before I put the lid on. And that's it. Ready, so we'll leave this a couple of hours, low heat, be patient, let all those ingredients mingle, talk, and create an amazing flavor. We're going to make the quick pickled cabbage salad, which is delicious. I love grating vegetables for salads because you create kind of very thinly grated vegetables, so your dressing really coats every bit of them perfectly. The texture is fantastic to just absorb all the flavors, especially when we do a fast pickled salad where you actually want that pickled flavor. White wine vinegar in your recipe, and that's fantastic. This is also sold here as white wine vinegar, even though it's like rosé, and it's a similar thing to what happens with our wine. So our white wine generally is more on the reddish side. So we're going to go in and be generous with the vinegar, and then we're going to add some sugar, just some white sugar, normal, nothing special. And we have salt, and again, just be generous because you want this salad to be punchy. I don't tend to put too much black pepper here, but you know, you can put as much as you like. So use your hands to mix this salad. I know lots of people don't like doing this, but it really makes a difference. I'm happy. I'm going to wash my hands and I'm going to come back and taste it. So time to taste. Mmm. It's delicious. It's amazing. The sugar's enough, the salt's enough. I'm really, really happy with it. I'm going to put it to one side and I'm going to add the mint leaves bit later, just so they stay lovely and green. Our stew is almost ready, so maybe needs another half an hour. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to prepare the carrots. So simply peel them, and then we are going to cut them in half lengthways, and then we're just on an angle, slice them into pieces. So carrots in the stew is smelling incredible. And that's it. So placing the lid on again, and I think we'll be eating in about half an hour. Let's have a look at the beef. Wow. It is looking incredible. There we go. The carrots are just cooked. The colour is just phenomenal. And the smell is fantastic. Absolutely amazing. I'm just going to taste the liquid, because this is the best way to see whether you need to adjust any seasoning. So any more pepper or any more salt, you add it right at the end. Fantastic. I promise you, it's fantastic. Oh. This is my recipe of braised beef with dried figs and fast pickled cabbage salad. This is a very special place for me to cook, and I hope you enjoy it and you love it as much as I do.
So let's talk about some of the recipes. A prawn and orzo dish.
Yep.
Phenomenal. And before we talk about the dish itself, you have some less than wonderful memories of prawns when you were a child.
Yeah. Well, you know, the prawns we used, which we're very lucky to have found them, are the small local prawns that,
right,
you know, come into season this time of year, and they're only available for 4 to 6 weeks, mm-hmm, so everyone has them. The problem is that they are small, mm-hmm, and they are quite hard to handle. So not if you've got one, but imagine you've got 10 kilos of them or a pile of them. In the same way that everyone wants to eat them during this time, mm-hmm, of year, my dad, who's a fisherman and uses the freshest bait, I've never seen anyone be so fussy about what bait goes on his hooks. It's the best stuff on the market. Mm. There isn't something that's used for bait and not eaten by us. You
okay.
know, it's of just the best quality. So same time of year, he would bring 30 kilos of these prawns in our kitchen, and he would be cleaning them while all my friends were swimming, and I would get caught up in our kitchen peeling prawns for 4 hours. And by the end of it, my poor hands would be just quite sore. So that was the bad experience of them. But, you know, there's been many good ones. And this dish that we cooked is quite amazing.
So what do I do?
So we'll just put
the shells in there?
The shells in here straight away. Since okay. we're cooking outdoors, we just have to be a bit more efficient.
Okay.
So shells in here,
okay.
flesh in here, and I'll show you how we do it.
Okay.
So you pull the head off.
Head off.
And you just follow, starting from the legs.
Okay, and just follow the body.
Follow the body, pull the tail, done. Ah.
Okay, not so bad.
Very done. Easy. So this orzo dish mm-hmm. is one of my favorites. So mm-hmm. we use orzo, which okay. is a small type of pasta, almost
okay.
like similar to the shape of rice.
Okay.
And it's used very much here. And a traditional way to use it is to bake it in the oven with lamb shanks.
Oh, okay.
And it's delicious. Mm-hmm. But it has started being used in other recipes. So combining it with seafood or fish, creating something lighter. I've created this recipe because, firstly, I love using courgettes with mm-hmm. prawns. I think they complement each other really, really well. Mm-hmm. And then I use this also because texturally the dish becomes fantastic,
right.
and also it becomes a bit more substantial.
Mm-hmm. Absorb a tremendous amount of flavor too.
We get these incredible prawns, mm-hmm. which basically means their shells are going to be full of flavor. Their heads, okay. their brown meat, everything is going to be amazing. So you cook these shells quickly to make a stock, and you don't even have to spend any time doing this. I'm going to get this stock on.
All
so
right.
initially, I'm just going to add a little bit of olive oil.
Okay.
And a tiny bit of salt, very simple. and I'm going to get them on kind of low heat. But you can almost drink the stock without doing anything else.
Right.
You know, you make a stock, you drink the stock, and that's enough. It's so lovely and flavorsome and just smells of the sea. And then you use this stock to cook your orzo. Mm-hmm. So yes, the orzo absorbs and cooks 100% using this lovely.
That's wonderful.
So, and even though the flavors of the prawn and the courgette are delicate, they work really well together, and the flavor comes from the stock really. And also, you know, I finish it off with lots of freshly chopped mint, which is a really Greek thing. So you get this fantastic aroma from the fresh mint. And then, of course, I add a little bit of brandy and I add a little bit of ouzo, which again are flavors that one will give the richness to a dish that has quite simple flavors. And the other one is almost like just making it the perfect dish for seafood, you know, having the ouzo and the aniseed. So it's a dish I love. You can make it 100% vegetarian. You can use mussels or you can use tuna or salmon or, you know, whatever's available and is fresh and is good. You know, it's more like understanding the method.
Right.
And then you can be as creative as you like. Yamas.
Yamas. Then yamas.
We cheers to our health.